God, you can tell the waves be still. Tell the ocean roar to pass, Lord, until it does. I'll wait here. God, you can part the raging sea. Bring the miracle I need, Lord, until it comes. I'll wait here. And I will sing songs in the night, praise in the storm, your God in it all. And I will stand, I'll be still and know, whatever may come, you got in it all. And so when I am in the storm, Lord, the storm is not in me, you will be my. Storm, you got in it all.
Lord, the storm is not in me. You will be my peace. I'll wait here. I'll wait here. I'll wait here.
Hi, a very good morning, church. As you can see, I'm not in church in Malacca. So this is recorded in Seremban, my own home. So if you suddenly hear screaming from the kids or someone running around you, it's perfectly all right and fine. So I hope you're blessed with the song, Songs in the Night, shared earlier. I just love the lyrics where it says, "And I will sing songs in the night, praise in the storm, you are God in it all." And as much as it has encouraged me, I pray that it has encouraged you as well. So the song Songs in the Night was actually taken from Job, Job 35, verse 10 to 11. It says, "But no one says, where is God, my maker, who gives songs in the night, who teaches us more than the beasts of the earth and makes us wiser than the birds of heaven?" And just want to pick up a few things today, which God allows the night and how we respond. We respond by listening, and we respond by singing and declaring. So this text was taken from the book of Job. And to just see the background of the book of Job, you can actually break it down into five sections. So the first section was Job was tested in Job chapter 1 to 2. And then the second section was the interaction between Job and his three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. Not really smart interaction. You can call them three stooges. Then the next section is Elihu, which is son of Barachel the Buzite. And then the fourth section is what God said to Job, which was from Job 38 to 41. And then in the last chapter was the restoration of Job. So what we can take from Job, even the first two chapters, is we see that God allowed nights to happen. God allowed Job to be tested. Job was a very rich person, a wealthy farmer. He has a lot of livestock, servants, and yet he was still righteous. So that's why in the first chapter that Satan went up to God and said, Job is righteous because of all the wealth you have given him. Take it away and you'll see him denying you. So God allowed Job to be tested. So from here we can see God allows nights to happen. Nights can be a form of a period of anxiety, a period of anxiousness, a period of discouragement, or a period where we are lack and things like that. But we must always know that God allows this to happen. One encouraging thing that we know is we may not know why or how long. Even if you see in the book of Job, when God restored Job and when God spoke to Job in the last chapter, God never told Job why he was tested. Imagine Job never knew that he was tested because Satan wanted to test his faith. And God wanted to test his faith. But what we know, God was watching. So he promises to always be with us, even during these nights, these periods of testing. I like how the way Philippians put it in his blog titled Living in Plague Times. I uploaded it in Facebook as well. I like he says that God is on the side of the sufferer. Almost instinctively, we react to suffering by thinking we must have done something wrong for which God is punishing us. But there's an easy correction to that innate response. Simply follow Jesus through the Gospels and watch his response to a widow who lost her only son, or even a Roman soldier whose servant has fallen ill. Never does he blame the victim or philosophize about the cause. Always, without exception, he responds with compassion, comfort, and healing. Christians believe that Jesus is, as Colossians tells us, the exact likeness of the unseen God. So if you want to know how God feels about people who are suffering, look at Jesus. God is on their side. And even beyond what Philippians wrote, we can hold on to these verses. In James chapter 1, verse 12 to 13, it says, "Blessed is a man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, 'I am being tempted by God,' for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one." God doesn't tempt us. And in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6 to 7, what he promises is, "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." So God allows nights and this period of testing so that one, we can, when we stand the test, we can receive the crown of life. And then it's also to test the genuineness of our faith, as we see in the story of Job as well. So I'd like to come back to the responses of the different characters in Job. The three friends, as I said earlier, we can call them three stooges. They immediately blame Job, saying that your suffering is a result of sin. They just came to the assumption and just accused Job for nearly 30 chapters. They accuse him, you're sinning. And that's why God is punishing you. But when we see Job's response, he knew he led a righteous life. But what happened was he moved away from the pious attitude shown earlier, and then he started berating God for the disproportionate judgment against him. But of course, he repented it in the end. So what we see was Job accusing God as being intrusive and suffocating. God as an angry, unforgiving, and punishing God. God as an unjust God. He's wicked. The wicked were taking advantage of the needy and helpless, but they still go unpunished. Job couldn't see why he was punished when there are so many injustices happening around the world. And sometimes this is the response we give ourselves. It's such a natural response that we start blaming God and we say things that are not right. But this is just a natural thing. But I love what Elihu was there and how he responded. In chapter 32 onwards, the first thing he did was he criticized the three friends for their assumptions and accusation. But what he did was he mentioned that Job had allowed himself to become proud and God was punishing him to humble him. This is actually just a little closer towards the truth, but it's not the truth. I mean, as we read, we know upon hindsight that God tested Job and God wasn't punishing Job. But because of the responses that Job gave, that's why Elihu mentioned that Job had allowed himself to become proud and God was punishing him to humble him. So that's where Elihu mentioned that this verse that I wanted to go to as well. In Job chapter 35, Elihu's advice to Job was, "Because of the multitude of operations, people cry out. They call for help because of the arm of the mighty." This is Elihu's generalization of what he has seen of people's responses when they are oppressed or they are anxious or they are in times of night. Then he says, but none says, where is God my maker, who gives songs in the night, who teaches us more than the beasts of the earth and makes us wiser than the birds of the heavens. So just wanted to highlight the part on who teaches us. So Elihu mentioned that God gives us songs in the night to teach us. So if God is teaching, are we listening? This is Job chapter 32. Yep. So we take it from verse 4 onwards. Now Elihu had waited to speak to Job because they were older. So they here is a three stooges. They were older than he. And when Elihu saw that there was no answer in the mouth of these three men, he burned with anger. And Elihu, the son of Barachel the Buzite, answered and said, I am young in years, and you are aged. Therefore I was timid and afraid to declare my opinion to you. I said, let days speak, and many years teach wisdom. But what he realized is, it is spirit in man, the breath of the Almighty, that makes him understand. It is not the old who are wise, nor the aged who understand what is right. Therefore I say, listen to me, let me also declare my opinion. So I wanted to highlight this, these two things that Elihu did. He actually listened. You see in verse 4, it says, Elihu waited to speak to Job. So he heard the whole discourse between Job's three friends and Job. And he heard all the accusations. And then that's why he burned with anger, because this is not right. The answer wasn't right. And to him, I've wasted time listening to you. But the important thing was, he listened. He listened to what's happening around. And in verse 8, it's about listening to God. Because he says, but it is the spirit in man, the breath of the Almighty, that makes him understand. So he believes that in listening to God, what God says, that makes him to be able to understand. So listening is a very key and important for us in these difficult times. It's not only listening to God, but listening to what is happening around us. So like here, he says, listen intently. Elihu listened intently to the discourse between the three friends and Job. Why we need to listen? Because during nights and periods of crisis, there's a lot of worries. This is reported in Free Malaysia Today, yesterday. On a normal day, this is the befrienders, the center receives a call every half an hour. I think that's a lot. But now about three calls come in within 30 minutes, she said. This is befrienders in Johor. This is taken from the news of worries over MCEOC Malaysians searching for a friendly ear. And over in Sabah, the director mentioned, on average, we have been getting 11 to 13 WhatsApp chats every night since the MCO started, which is an increase for us. The last part is taken from Talian Kasih. Talian Kasih is basically a hotline for abuse, family members, kids, wives, that they can call to make a complaint. And what she mentioned was, the number of calls has increased by 57% during the MCO. It said a lot of callers were also asked seeking advice regarding the pandemic. This was from the news. MCO causes spurt in number of calls to helpline for kids abuse. So we can see here that in the times of crisis, a lot of people are looking for answers. A lot of people are looking for a listening ear. And that's why I believe that we as Christians, we should be there ready to listen. We may not have the solution, we may not have the answer now, but just be prepared to listen, as how much Elihu listened to whole 30 chapters of the discourse between Job and the three friends. We should also be ready to listen, to give a friendly ear. And then the next thing that is important is listening to God to gain understanding. And there's a follow-on verse which I'd like to share, what Elihu mentioned in Job 36. And Elihu continued and said, "Bear with me a little, and I will show you, for I have yet something to say on God's behalf. I will get my knowledge or understanding from afar and ascribe righteousness to my Maker." I mean, acknowledging God for that wisdom, for what he's saying. "For truly my words are not false. One who is perfect in knowledge is with you." One thing I would like to highlight here is at the end of the last two chapters of Job, God condemned the three friends for what they are saying, which is not true. But God did not say anything at all about what Elihu said. So there's a bit of justification to what Elihu mentioned in this verse, that what he's saying is to say on God's behalf. So the key point here is, why do we listen? We listen to what people are saying on the ground. We listen to what God is trying to say, so that we can bring the right words and right songs to the people around us, to provide words of healing, to provide words of comfort, and to provide compassion. It has to be wise words. So what do we sing about? What do we say about? As believers, we can always go back to remembering His kindness, remembering His goodness, and remembering His mercies. And this song stuck in my head. We sing about the goodness of God. He says, "And all my life, you have been faithful. And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God." When we come to periods of anxiety and stress and turmoil, it is good for us to always go back and remember that God is kind, God is good, and God is merciful. What else can we sing about? This is what Elihu did also. You can see this in chapters 37 and 38. He extolled God's greatness. He proclaimed God's majesty. To see God's greatness, and it's also an acknowledgement for us that there's an authority above us. There's someone reigning over us. So we look to Him in humility. We look to Him in guidance. And it is something beyond our own understanding. And these words, these lyrics came to mind, and I think we sang on the last service before this MRO take place. It's from the song, "What a Beautiful Name It Is." And in the bridge part, it says, "You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, our God reigns. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names." It's an encouragement for us to see that God is still reigning over all. All this is parts and plans and purposes. And to proclaim His majesty, to proclaim His kingship over the situation and over our lives. So what else can we sing about? We can sing about the night itself, like in Matt Raymond's songs. "And I will sing songs in the night. We can sing even this verse. This song came to mind, and I think Eddie shared this song. He was playing on the guitar, and he shared a video with us during this time. When the oceans rise and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storms. Father, you are king. This is acknowledging God as well. Father, you are king over the floods, and I will be still. No, you are God. It's just the acknowledgement of King as King, acknowledgement of this difficult period, but also to know that for us, we can be still and know that He is God over everything in our lives. And what else can we sing this song as well? A hope for the future, when these nights would pass. I really thank God that now at this period of time, we see nights passing over in China, over in Wuhan. There's a very few reported cases in China, and we know that this will happen in Malaysia as well. And this will also happen in Europe. During this darkest period, thousands of deaths, we know it will pass. And for us to look towards it, so this song came to mind. I look to you, you are my healer. I look to you, you restore my soul. I look to you, Jesus, Redeemer. For all to look to you will be made whole. This is a song about restoration. And I really look forward to it. One thing that I really look forward to as well is for us as a church to come together and worship Him together. After I took over the audio ministry, I really know nuts about it or things I did, and a lot of things is learning and finding out from friends and from experts and things like that. So at first it started with a lot of technical things, or how many dB or how loud the sound should be or things like that, or how soft the drums should be or how soft the piano should be, and everything is technical. But as I begin to listen more each Sunday and trying to be sensitive to sounds, I realized the best sounds was the sound of the church singing. It drowns out individual imperfections, but it's such a joy and such beauty to hear the church singing together. So I shared this even with James and Lambert, and when I was asked, what do I look for in sound? I say the first priority that I will look for is, can I hear the church sing? Can I hear the church worship? And this is something that I really look forward when these things pass, and the restoration of worship in our church. And I really look forward to that. Looking beyond what we say, even what I say about what we sing, we can share that with the people around us. And this is something I read about Martin Luther's response during the bubonic plague period. He said, I shall ask God mercifully to protect us. Then I shall fumigate, help purify the air, administer medicine and take it. I shall avoid places and persons where my presence is not needed, in order not to become contaminated and thus perchance inflict and pollute others and so cause their death as a result of my negligence. If God should wish to take me, He shall surely find me, and I have done what He has expected of me. And so I am not responsible for either my own death or the death of others. If my neighbor needs me, however, I shall not avoid place or person, but will go freely as stated above. See, this is such a God-fearing faith because it is neither brash nor foolhardy and does not tempt God. This is what Martin Luther said during the bubonic plague. I like the part where he says, I ask, pray that God to protect us, then I shall fumigate, help purify the air, and administer medicine and take it. And also, if my neighbor needs me, however, I shall not avoid place or person, but I will go freely as stated above. I think Martin Luther's time is difficult. There's no phone or, or things like that. So he really has to go there. But during our times, we have WhatsApp, we have phone calls, and we have Facebook, social media. There's so much of ways that we can reach out and go to our neighbors and go to our friends and sing songs of encouragement with them. So to summarize what I've shared, so during this period, let's listen and respond with words of healing, compassion, and comfort. So I hope you've been blessed by this sharing.
Lived in the goodness of God.